So, Sam, what's the topic for this week?
This week, we're going to talk about how you can build a business using organic social media, basically.
Interesting topic.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you why. So this is kind of like the dream. Did you listen to the Mark Manson interview with Tim Ferriss?
I did, yeah. I talked about it last week.
Oh, of course you did. Yeah, well, I've slept since then and we're a little bit behind, aren't we, on recording. Because of me, because I missed one. He brought something up there, which it just resonated with me big time, which was, so Tim, you don't know, but we've had this relationship that you're completely unaware of. Quite a tortured start to the relationship, which is, you write this 4-hour work week, the Bible, as I refer to it, and it says it's all sunshine and roses, but it took me like 6 years of sleeping on couches and trying to figure out what didn't work and building SEO sites and, you know, whatever else. And I tell you the reason I'm thinking of James Clear is because he, from Atomic Habits, he said the same thing about the same sort of time. He started building all these random little websites for selling, I don't know, like cutlery and supplements and like whatever, just to figure out basic marketing. And I thought it'd be really good to say, well, you know, there is a world where you start, where you're freelancing, where we both started, which was where you're going, well, I know some stuff and I've got access to this free platforms, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, TikTok, and how do you use them? Like, how do you use them to figure out what your product is, to figure out what you're going to sell and build an audience, figure out what your business is going to be, because that's what you're doing in the beginning. And that you're going to put a load of time and effort in. And is that an effective way of doing it? Or should you just be running paid ads like straight off the bat? I've obviously, like in our notes, I've got a couple of stories, a couple of things to talk about, experiments we've run, specifically how you can earn £120 an hour is the hook for Twitter. You know, how you can earn £120 an hour from Twitter, 7-hour startup, you know, basically how to get your first 7 customers using content. But that's what I wanted to talk about. And you're a marketing dude-ess, so you know this.
Yeah, well, I'm a dudess, yes. And I am a dudess, and I do have lots of opinions about using social platforms for marketing. I guess it all starts with Facebook. If we go back in time, maybe 12 years, right, when Facebook decided to bring Facebook pages out and say to everyone, we don't like you talking about business on your personal profile. Here's a Facebook page. Put your business up on here. Go and claim it. Off ye go. And total Wild West. And some businesses did incredibly well, having a Facebook page, using that Facebook page to put all of their business content. You didn't even need a website, right? You could be found in Facebook, searched for in Facebook, connected with in Facebook. And the reach at that time would have been incredible, right? So your business would have shown up in someone's feed, you know, 2-3 times a day, maybe, right? So Facebook pages became, you know, the kind of the go-to for a lot of small businesses, a lot of startups, because they were free and had great reach and great attention at the time. And then, you know, the day came where Facebook wanted to punt its ad service more and it put the brakes on Facebook pages. So now if you have someone like your Facebook page, chances are that less than 10% of total followers will see those posts in their feed. So the reach is incredibly capped. It's really capped, right? However, that cultural moment in terms of the reach and the potential of Facebook pages hasn't really gone away from the minds of small businesses, especially those who were on Facebook like 10, 15 years ago, right? My age being, you know, people in their 40s being one of them, right? And I still hear this all the time from small businesses, which is, well, I need to get some more Facebook page likes. It's like, why? Why would you go after an attention source where when you do get that like, less than 10%, so you get 100 people liking your page, less than 10 of those are going to see your stuff. And then you have to post every single day, if not a little bit more, in order to be seen. The other thing that's part of the kind of culture from the kind of past 10, 12 years to do with that is the kind of rise of, you know, content ninjas. Like
content marketing.
Yeah, like Gary Vaynerchuk, right? It's a great example. You know, he's someone who has just aced it organically on every social platform. And, you know, as time's gone on, he's got better at it because he's brought his reputation and his other audiences to those. But one of the things that he spoke about, you know, 5-6 years ago when I sort of first started following him was you've got to post not just once a day. I post 8 times a day, right? And
yeah. Multiple times.
Yeah, and people could see the rise of his success, the increase in his audience, and it became a kind of go-to tactic in the kind of online entrepreneur, solopreneur, coach, very small business space, you know, which is that you have to have a Facebook page and you have to post 10 times a day or whatever.
We like rules, don't we? We like accreditation. A page feels like, oh, someone gave me approval to do this, therefore it's the right thing. We kind of spoke about marketing basics the other week, but let's just give a framework. You know that I like a framework. Shops on the high street, the reason that a high street used to work was because you had foot traffic. You had people there, they'd walk past, they'd go, oh, that's a thing I like. Go into the shop, or a brand I like, or a specialist shoe shop, or snooker shop, or fishing shop. It's like, oh, I need fishing gear, I go to the fishing shop. But the internet's kind of changed that. And now we've got all of these traffic sources. And I guess that what you're saying, like Gary Vee absolutely nailed the ability of kind of just putting his name on every virtual high street that was out there. He's got Facebook stories, reels, Instagram reels, pictures, feeds, podcasts, and like up the yin yang. It's like you walk down your digital high street and you're in our domain, which is, you know, business and marketing. You see the Gary Vee shop. He's everywhere. And that's kind of what he's done. But I think there's kind of like a, well, go on, you were saying about the ninja way of doing it.
Well, the reason why he's a ninja, right, is because you talked about the system, right? And, you know, and he famously published his system, right? Which is that he creates these pillars of content, video, podcast, and then cuts those all up and puts them out onto social platforms so people can get mini hits of that pillar content. And that's how he's posting 8 times a day, right? So he's taking that one bit of content and slicing it and dicing it up, right? Yeah. But other people are looking at that and going, well, Gary Vee's posting 8 times a day every single day. They're not connecting the dots that he's creating a very incredibly good piece of content that's high quality, whether it's his video or podcast, in terms of the value that it gives people, and slicing and dicing that up for his audience. He's not just putting posts out for the sake of putting posts out. It's not just volume at all costs. It's quality diced up into lots of smaller pieces of value. And the issue with the whole content is king world that we've seen over the past like 10 years is that quantity has been valued much more over quality. And that's because people think, well, I just need to get seen more. But getting seen more for a product or service isn't great marketing. It isn't putting you on. Dan Kelso talks about this from Views of My Own on their podcast. You know, it's still a turd. You know, it's just a turd that people are going to see more often, right? And I think that's a really important point to note from the kind of Facebook page days as well, because a lot of small businesses, because they saw a Facebook page, it was easy entry to market. Great, I don't need a website, right? Got myself a Facebook page. Oh, I love posting on Facebook. So great, I can do the same on Facebook pages. I can just post every day. And then the kind of laziness set in, which is, oh, well, I've done something on my personal profile. I'll just reshare it to my Facebook page. Now, as a user, how valuable is your reshared post from your personal profile to your page for me? Not very. Versus Gary Vee, who's created a micro piece of content that fits the dimensions of TikTok exactly. It's got captions on it, and it's got they've edited a header and footer on it where he said, hey, TikTok, just a quick message. He's thought about the platform that he's posting on. He's not just churning content out for the kind of sake of it. And that's where we're at with content marketing. Like, you can either create really good pieces of content that's going to give value to your audience, or you can just keep resharing posts and memes that you've seen. You can keep putting blog posts on Facebook when Facebook will never promote an external link on a feed. You know, you can keep posting your horizontal videos on a vertical video platform. Like, you can keep doing these things, but it's not going to be a great experience for the end user. And that's a really important part of great content marketing.
Yeah, definitely. So let's talk about some of the reasons that content marketing is great. So Dan Norris, this is the guy I'm thinking of. So he's written this book, The 7-Day Startup. He's not very well known, I don't think, is Dan Norris, but is running successful companies off the back of content marketing. He's got a brewery company and he's also launched his book. If I was to guess, 7 figures, maybe a bit beyond. And he basically makes the point that you go and talk about one specific problem, one specific niche. So, you know, for instance, brewing beer, you become known for that niche. So you are aiming to just own that shop on the high street. And I think that's a big part of what you're trying to do, is talk about one specific thing to one specific person in one specific way. And if you can keep beating that drum, it beats this approach that you're talking about, where people are just throwing content out to see what sticks to the wall. I mean, I think on Facebook's weird, like, it's different to all the other social platforms because it's very much about individuals that have a personal presence on there. So pictures of their kids, and they talk about family and a little bit about problems, which is sometimes a bit weird, and then a little bit about their business and then stuff they've learned and goals, and it's kind of a bit all over the place. And when you certainly when I go through my Facebook feed, it's a lot of like, oh, well, I'm really seeing this person, versus you go on.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, but Sam, like, you're much younger than me, right? Rewind back to the glory days of Facebook, 2006. We would post anything on there. Anything on there, like nights out, what we're thinking. It was a brilliant, glorious time. And, you know, and it was only around about 2015, I had a baby and I went through my feed and I was like, I should probably get rid of those pictures of me at Glastonbury from 2003. I think that would be a good idea. And those pictures from me from that club night I was at in Ibiza in 2010, you know. So we used to really overshare back in the day, right?
Yeah, no, well, when I got my security clearance, when I knew I was coming up for it, I did something very similar. That's like, oh, there's a picture of me 19 years old passed out on some grass. Probably don't want the world to see that. That's not a good one for a future employer.
It's all right, but the kids are doing that on TikTok now. They're way oversharing and doing things I never would have talked about, like, you know.
Tears, crying, I'm having a tough time. There's a lot of that going on. Right, okay. So let's dive in. I've got some examples. I've a reason that I wanted to talk about this. I did an experiment. Now, if you've been listening to the podcast for a while, you'll know that I like data and I like stuff that you can touch. And Twitter is, regardless of whether you like Twitter or not as a user, is great because you can basically, for the meantime, until Elon Musk changes his mind at least, access all the data. You can see pretty much anyone's account. You can see, although they've just bought in a private mode, but you can see how many replies they've made. You can see how many impressions they got, profile clicks, new followers, all kinds. And on your own profile, you can see this. And I had a theory that you could start to reach out to people and you would get a response rate back that would be profitable. Because I was thinking, well, let's say you spend an hour a day as a high-paid individual trying to engage on Twitter with people. How does that translate into money? Like, what's that actually worth? And so I pulled the data. I analyzed 89 replies. So a reply, I went and found people talking about a specific topic on Twitter, which we won't get into how I did that, but it's quite an efficient process. I made 89 replies. That was interesting. Have you thought about X, Y, Z? Each reply took me around about a minute, so about 89 minutes. So, you know, an hour and a half-ish, more or less. Those 89 replies resulted in 103,700 impressions. So that was how many people sort of kind of looked at that tweet as best as they can measure on Twitter. Vicky, you'll be able to tell me how well they are or aren't measuring that. Those impressions resulted in 537 profile clicks. So that's people coming through to my profile and having a look at it. I was split testing my profile. So they come, they land on Sam Jack. So who's this guy? They've seen my reply. They've now clicked through to my profile to see who I am. And of those 540-ish profile clicks, that resulted in 50 followers, about a 10% conversion. And I've been optimizing that conversion. And of those 50 new followers, I got 10 new email subscribers. So about 20% conversion rate to my email. And now, hypothetically, my email list converts around 10%. I'm not selling anything at the moment, didn't send an email to anyone. But I usually sell products around about the £200 to £1,000 mark, depending on what it is. But let's go with a £200 product, one sale. That means that each of those replies, around about 90 replies, was worth about £2. I'd get one sale from that 90 minutes of work. So around about £120 an hour. Now, this is just an example. It's clearly not an exact science, and clearly there's so many variables in there. But I was looking at this going, huh, I'm only just figuring this out. That's really interesting, because I was looking at the email lead cost there. You know, so I got 10 new email subscribers. I was saying that each of those leads cost about £2 or £3 based on the time and the effort. I was thinking, well, I know email leads are pretty expensive through paid ads at the moment, at least, depending on the product you sell. And I know there's a massive range, but that just kind of lit a bulb with me that went, oh, this creator economy thing where this seems very popular at the moment, where it's individuals or small businesses that are investing a lot in organic content marketing and social media presence, like the economics work there. Like if you want to build a 6 to 7 figure business, very realistically, that's just from replies. That's not, I put a post out there and a percentage of my audience shared it, which resulted in new followers and sales. And all I did was spend an hour on a post. Like that was manual, like outbound, very predictable. I schedule 90 minutes and I can get that money back, more or less, fairly predictably. And I thought, well, that's super fascinating. And I have been trying to replicate this and turn this into a checklist. And I haven't got more data for you yet. I will share it in a future podcast. But I've connected with two data scientists. One guy in Brazil has absolutely cracked it. Like he is downloading the data every day and sharing it every day. Very, very interesting. He's gone from 0 followers to 3,500 in like 40 days or so. And a German data scientist who's done very similar. They're blowing my mind a little bit. But I'm going to call myself a fairly normal person with not really any of the data science skills and definitely not any of the marketing skills. This was fascinating. And it kind of reminded me of the Dan Norris book, The Content Marketing Piece. He basically said you can create a business inside of 7 days. Day one, brainstorm a load of ideas. Day two, write down the product. Day three, come up with names. Day four, build yourself a website. Day five, build a list of marketing methods. Day six, create a launch plan. Day seven, launch. And I was like, okay, well, I remember reading that and seeing that that was really efficient. And Tim Ferriss's process, kind of similar. But I did all of that in like 2 hours. And it was pretty fascinating. What do you think? What are you saying? Am I just had a lucky break?
Observationally, with the clients that I work with some really big online entrepreneurs. I also work with small businesses as well, right? If you can get a hook, a break like that, where you can find a bit of content that resonates with people and they want to hand their email over or go and click through to a place where you're selling stuff, then great, right? But to keep the consistency of that in order for it to be a business model that is sustainable is incredibly difficult. You've just talked about 2 hours work there. Well, okay, how many, you know, with your process hat on, how many of those hours would you need to work in order to have 100K turnover business, 1 million K turnover business?
I'm so glad you asked that, because I was there going, all right, well, is it feasible? Like, let's say a million quid a year, you want to be making about £500 an hour, I think, 40 hours a week. From memory, I haven't done the math in my head. That's memory, so it could be wrong.
Pub maths with Sam Jacks, yeah.
So you're not, you know, this method isn't going to get you to 1 million quid, but it is the compounding effect, like 50 new followers on a regular basis plus other strategies. It can't be your only strategy, for sure.
No, No. And to this point, right, going back to the Facebook page technique that everyone saw how easy it was, jumped on the bandwagon, is that that one tactic marketing approach has been abused by online product sellers, right? Because everyone wants to show you how can you achieve the results as quickly as possible with the least amount of effort as possible, you know. And it's why the 4-hour work week as a hook was so popular, because if you can say to people, I'll show you how to make a million quid business by only posting once a day, you're going to be like, yeah, like obviously I'm going to go down that route. But the truth is that you can get the hook, you can get that initial jolt of interest, but then you have to do the work on top of that. So you think about the kind of people who they look like they were overnight successes online, but actually the truth is they were grinding for a really long time doing content, you know. And just coming to mind, obviously, my pal Helen Pritchard, Helen Tudor now from Get Leads from LinkedIn, she was doing that grind for like, I don't know, like 3 or 4 years at least before, you know, she kind of went a little bit viral with it all and kind of had her million quid turnover year in 2019 or 2020 or whenever it was. She'd managed to find a way in, a kind of a hook, and then really went all in on that afterwards. She didn't just do the kind of same one trick pony thing kind of again and again. She wasn't just, you know, doing that one thing over and over and over without thinking about how to kind of grow the business in other ways. And she set up challenges and webinars and, you know, things like that.
Yeah, so for business growth, I think it's really different, isn't it, to the tactics and approach you would apply to a business that you've validated. And that's probably we're drilling down now into the value. If you've got a validated business and you go, well, my average customer transaction value is 500 quid. Well, I know that I can pay £100 then to get 10 leads and I'll convert 1 in 10 and I'll still make £400. You could afford to do that. But when you're in the beginning phase and you're trying to figure out, well, what am I selling? Who am I selling it to? What's my target audience? And you spoke in one of the earlier episodes, you were saying about the market research you did where you threw a quiz out to try and like figure out your demographic. Well, that initial catalyst there, I think, is the really difficult bit. And I guess what I'm trying to say is, for me, as an engineer, I can look at, you know, Helen Pritchard as an example, like you say, or I could look at...
like James Wedmore or Amy Porterfield. She grinded for years before she kind of took off.
Yeah, and you look at these people and it's quite difficult to reverse engineer what they did at the beginning to get started. You can see what's working now, because they've absolutely fine-tuned it. And this is really, I've been trying to unpick the science from really idea validation is what we're talking about.
I have to say, sometimes there isn't a science, right? There isn't, because like in the case of Helen, like she went for volume. She went live every day on her personal profile and used her personal profile as her way. And that volume and just being exposed to so many people led people to being kind of attracted to her and wanting to find out more about like what she had to offer. So her personality kind of really shone through, right? Amy Porterfield made... videos in, you know, you look at her videos now, like there's some of them are still on YouTube, you know, really bad lighting and stuff, but she made training videos and she did that year in, and then it was just like, you know, I think it was email marketing that kind of finally took off for her, and she sort of found the kind of the right hook and the right, you know, the right niche at the right time. And I think it was the same for Helen, you know, it's at the right time, because you could spend a long time putting the same content out to the same audience and it only takes that one person to go, yeah, I'll buy your first thing, and then, you know, you're off to the races. But you might wait a year or 2 or 3 years for that to happen, right? Alternatively, you could be putting out the same thing to the same audience and actually, like, the truth is, it's not what they want, you know, and at some point you're going to have to give up the ghost and come move on to something else. But you need to be testing long enough to know if the method that you're using, the offer that you're putting out, the words, the imagery, the pricing is right, but then not giving it up too soon, because it just might take another month, another 2 months, another 12 months, another 2 years even before your kind of big break comes with the content that you produce, not just being seen by the people who follow you, but then being viral worthy enough to be seen by others.
Yeah, I'm so with you. So there's a few things that really stand out to me. It's first of all, you know, no one wants to get embarrassed by posting stuff online. But let's just be really clear. Like, if you post something a bit crap and everyone sees it, like the whole world saw it, you wouldn't have a problem because you would, enough of the whole world would like your crap thing and buy it that you would be fine. So that's never going to be the problem. And some people will like it, great. Some people ignore it. Well, if you're not posting anything at the moment anyway, so they're already ignoring you. Some people won't like you. Well, they weren't going to like you anyway. So you literally, there's not a loss to be had by trying this. And if we can just dive into like the testing approach. I've read multiple times now from different authors. I think the name Tiago Forte, the optimization guy. I think he builds second brains and things. Tim Ferriss, James Clear, a number of big authors that are very successful. They talk very similarly to the Gary Vee approach. They come up with, you know, a book outline, or they come up with an outline of these content pillars that they want to talk about, and they map it all out. And then each chapter of their book, essentially, they come up with the idea of a long form blog post. And then that long form blog post becomes lots of micro content, and they test it. They say, well, if I talk about saving time as having more time, having more freedom, reducing stress, like what's the best way to talk about this thing to these people for it to resonate? And the way that they measure that is they literally schedule these posts out several times that with all the different syntax, and you can use AI if you aren't capable of doing this copywriting yet, you can say, rewrite this for me 10 different ways. They put it out and then they measure how much engagement did it get? How many likes, how many clicks, how many impressions, how many reshares? And they measure and they go, oh, right, nailed it. Okay, well, that can go in the book now. And that's how they assemble these best-selling books. They're not necessarily just pieces of art. And I'm not saying this is the only way, but this is a way that seems to really work. And I think really what I'm seeing, what I'm experiencing, what I wanted to talk about, I guess, is the value of you can validate an idea really quickly. To your point about you've got to hit a trend. Like if you were talking about remote working in, I don't know, any time before 2019, really, you would probably be on a growing trend. Like digital nomads were starting to become a thing. More people wanting sort of more flexibility. But COVID has been like a catalyst. And now it's quite often the norm to have some form of remote work. Like you couldn't have created that marketing buzz. If you just tap into, oh, you know, I sell air and there's a shortage of air. Well, guess what? You're going to have a lot of customers because everyone needs air. Like that's a thing now. Let's talk about the validation framework to begin with. Initially, you've got to come up with an idea. You then want to develop a hypothesis. Okay, I think people want this for this much in this time. You've then got to come up with an experiment to test this, and then you've got to validate it. So I did this. I'm at the moment, this is my old office. My new office is available today. I will be moving in the next week. The podcast studio is going to change. And I was talking with a friend who's like done some architecture, some engineering. He's a designer, basically. And I was saying to him, you know, I need to redesign my office. I need some help. I need new furniture. I need to figure out the lighting. I need to figure out all this stuff. And he said, oh, you need a Pimp My Space. And I was like, Pimp My Space, what's that? And he's like, oh, it's a service where basically you can go out there and a designer will help you use the latest tech and the latest colors to design an office. I was like, that's amazing. So I go online, www.pimpmyspace.com. There's nothing at this URL. And I go back to him going, there's nothing there. He's going, yeah, no, I made it up. It's just an idea. And I was like, that's an awesome idea.
Validated.
Yeah, brilliant. So then, let me pull up the post. So then I put together the post. I put my limited copywriting skills to work. And I go to a group called Trends. You still in Trends? Are you still using Trends?
Yeah.
Right. So Trends, for anyone listening that's not in, is basically a group of business owners, entrepreneurs. It's an American thing. There's like 14,000 members in there now. It's the paid membership of The Hustle. I think there's even a couple of billionaires in there. So some serious people in there. And so I put this post out, Pimp My Space, a service specializing in home and small office design and management for YouTubers, podcasters, and digital creators. Working closely with our user to combine the latest tech, styles, furniture, and lighting to give you a badass office people will shout about. Great for your brand, fantastic for productivity, unrivaled in taste. And then I put at the bottom, Please can you provide feedback on this idea? Would you consider this service? If so, what would you expect the result to be? I'm considering this as a business investment. And then I pulled some pictures off Instagram and credited them from, and I'll give them a shout out here, NAJ Visuals and Calm Setups on Instagram. They're just awesome offices with like huge screens and great paint and artwork and colours. And I'm sure everyone's got abs and it just looks great. And like, it looks incredible. This is where the idea then went. So I then basically put this pitch out and the response was incredible.
Why? What made it incredible?
60 people responded with an emotion and 54 comments replied back. And the comments were, yes, would be a great service to have. We need someone to do this now. I think this would be cool. How much would they charge? Is it just tech or is it interior design? I would do it. Every time I have a Zoom meeting, I'm rearranging the background so I can look more professional. It never looks awesome. I would totally do this. I think it's really fun. Plus, if you have an influencer giving out brand shout outs for a small discount, that'd be free advertising. Amazing. I'm helping a friend do this now. If it's a real thing, I'd get it for my home and office. I'd pay for this. Then some information on the post. Lots and lots of feedback. I was like, okay, bit of signal there. So then I took it to the next stage.
Oh, what's the next stage? Sorry.
I was like, okay, this is interesting. So then, I've put this inside of our little notes in the chat. I then put together a Google form for these people. And I'm saying, when do you need the office upgrading complete? And asked them to put dates in. I asked them, what's their budget range? And I started at 500 quid to 10 grand. And what would you want? Do you want a one-to-one design consultation service? Do you just want a list of stuff to buy? Do you want a course to go for? And it was nuts that the response, 50% of the people that commented then went through to this Google form, which no styling on it, no anything. It was literally just, hi, I'm Sam from Trends. Here's a question for you. And we got, I need it by the 31st of Jan. I need it like a load in February. The budgets ranged from 2 grand all the way up to 8.5 grand. The median seemed to be around about 5 grand, which was really fascinating. Most people wanted, about a third of people just wanted a checklist. A load of people wanted a design consultation service. Really, really fascinating. Now, the next thing is clearly to say to these people, let's get on a call and I'll have a bit, do some more customer discovery. But for me, this was incredible because, you know, as I suggested, maybe the hook for this podcast could be, you know, the 7-hour startup, how to launch a business in 7 hours, because the 4-hour work week is great. And all of these techniques for content marketing are great once you've established a business idea. But this was like idea validation. And I could have as well done it on Reddit or in a forum or anywhere else where the target audience was. That isn't so much like you were saying, because it's a fantastic idea. Like I have since, by the way, found someone who's selling this kind of service, and it starts at a £1,500 phone call for an hour. They've actually been featured on My First Million. They set up the My First Million podcast studio. So I should have picked up on that one. They're smashing it. 10 grand to come out and set your office up without buying any kit. It's unreal. So validated, tick. But that isn't just because it's a great idea. It's because most people are remote now. Most people are plugged into the computer doing what we're doing right now. Like, or a lot of people are. It's a tidal wave.
Yeah, but also as well, like it's the right audience in the right group, you know. So you're going to where there is already attention. And so, you know, social is really good for that, because if you know people are going to respond to a poll and be engaged, and it's a kind of around content that type of user would already be interested in, then you're onto a win. But if you're starting out with a brand new idea and you don't know your target market, you've got to schlep around and find the place where those people live, and then be able to get in with that group enough so that they will trust you to want to give you validation. You know, so it's why you've got to earn karma points on Reddit, right? Because you can't just rock up to any old subreddit and then just start posting, you know, your business or asking people what they want. Like you kind of got to go in and earn your stripes. And it's the same way any really good Facebook group worth its weight will have a moderator that doesn't allow posting of ads, or even those sly secret ads, you know, which is, hey, who's really enjoying email marketing at the moment? And, you know, they're going to DM anyone that kind of comments in the underneath the post.
Just wanted to share a great win I had.
Yeah, you know, all of that humble brag stuff, right? But no, you have to schlep around and find those people. And sometimes you can't, you as that business owner aren't going to be able to connect with those people, because like if you're a 50-year-old guy and you want to sell, you know, like shapewear to like, you know, early 20s, you know, Gen Zs, you know, like you're going to have to find ambassadors to go and do that job for you and connect with them that way, right? So, Gary Vee talks about this again. It's about going where the attention is already online and knowing where that audience is online, and then the content marketing that you do to them and the A/B testing that you do to them is going to work. If you are posting in a business Facebook group that you're in about, you know, the gardening tools that you're going to launch, you know, you're not going to get much traction, right? You need to go on a gardening forum, because people who are over 60 they're probably going to be on a Facebook group or on a forum, because that's the internet from 20 years ago, you know, and they ain't going to be on TikTok 100%.
What do you think then about less sexy, off the beaten track places to get traffic? Like we mentioned forums and Facebook groups, because it seems like the go-to is we'll run some paid ads, and that's going to cost money. It's relatively predictable, very targeted. There's definitely a strategy there. Definitely, 100%. But I'm thinking, well, what if you're figuring this out, you're hacking away at it? I mean, buying Facebook groups that are in the niche, like that seems like you'd get really good ROI.
Yeah, I mean, again, it really depends on the product and the users, right? Because Facebook ads work really well because there's so many people on the platform. Like this week, they said the most amount of people, daily average users than ever before, right? It's like 10 gazillion or something like that, or so Mark would have us believe now, right? So, you know, hopefully their profits will go up after they've like bragged about that. But, you know, there are a demographic who aren't on Facebook and they're never going on Facebook. I spoke to a potential client yesterday. She said, I got a Facebook 10 years ago. I've never been back on. Honestly, my mouth was like, it's like, how do you live? Like, you know, and I probed her and it turns out she did have an Instagram account and a WhatsApp. So she was in, like, she did have some of the ecosystem of products. Yeah, for sure. Facebook ads would work if your people are on there. If they're not, they're not going to work. So again, if you're going to spend money on ads, you need to know if your people are going to be reachable via ads first. But in terms of niche communities, like I worked with a fishing tackle client last year, antique fishing tackle. That is a niche group and they are very protective of their community. They have a forum, actually. They have a private forum. Yeah. And that, you know, there is a Facebook group. I worked with a whiskey client and the people, you know, family-owned brewery and things like that, the people who follow that whiskey brand really into it, you know, and they have their own supporters group and stuff. So, you know, when they're really engaged and really into it, like they are, I mean, there's some really amazing subreddits out there where the communities are tight-knit. I think Quora is underestimated in terms of the kind of communities that creates there. And then there's communities that we don't even know about that are out there, like WhatsApp groups, Instagram groups, you know, from last year as well, you know, where they might only have 100 people in there, but the buying power is probably bigger than if someone was in a 1,000-person Facebook group, really. So you have to know your audience and you have to get in the weeds. And if you don't, you need to find the early adopters of your product and ask them, because they're going to know where their peers are, basically. And connect with them enough so that you can then get your content in front and start A/B testing. And because once you've validated the idea with them, they're like, yeah, great, new fishing tackle range, we'll have that. Or yeah, new whiskey drop, yeah, brilliant, have that. You've then got to use your content marketing with those guys to test, okay, this bottle or this bottle, this headline or this headline. I think a really good go-to expert about this is Brendan Kane. You know, Brendan Kane, he wrote 1 million followers and he basically built a massive social media following of 1 million followers through...
This one? I have got it.
You've got it. Yeah. There you go. That's the one. Yeah. If you're listening, you're missing Sam showing off his book collection at me there. Have you read it though?
Yeah, I've... Not to go off on a tangent, I always download the audiobook and buy the real book.
He's great to listen to.
I've listened to it. Go on, what's a too long didn't read version of that? Like, didn't he say, like, at the time, I'm sure you could basically buy followers for less than a penny? And he's like, well, I could just spend 1 million pennies and get these followers, very low value, and I'd have a million followers. It's great social proof.
Yeah, I mean, that's your engineer hat on there, isn't it? But basically, he worked with a lot of actors, PR companies, Hollywood, you know, to try and build those sort of influencer profiles. And they would buy a lot of traffic, yep, to get those initial likes. And then what happens is you go past the tipping point with likes, because once you have enough, then when you drive more traffic, it kind of, the graph goes up exponentially where people trust, oh yeah, like I want to sign up. And then they were able to use the organic channels, so like a Facebook page, for example, to A-B test different headlines, different videos, different images, and really nail into like the hooks. And then they were able to feed that knowledge back into the ads that they were running and just beautifully create this sort of beautiful optimization machine, really, where they're able to get that initial traffic to the page, use that initial traffic to A-B test, then take the results of that A-B test and put into ads and then keep growing. Amplify that traffic. It. Yeah, basically. Hook is everything. Like, it's how do you get people to stop scrolling and kind of pay attention, really.
I've been blown away by this when testing on Twitter. I've tried the same article with three or four different hooks, and the results, like, and just to be clear, the hook is like, you know, the headline, not clickbaity, but you basically, you a number in there, a question and like a call to action, you know, seven things you wish you knew about XYZ, you know, and everyone's like, oh, I don't want that kind of thing. But if you deliver the value in the post, it doesn't matter.
Yeah, I feel like I kind of check my, you know, soul into the door a little bit when I'm coming up with headlines on ads or blog posts, really, because I, you know, it's the equivalent of just sort of standing out in the road and just flashing a little bit of leg, isn't it, really? You know, you just want them
no one's stopping for my legs.
You just want them to slow down and just pay attention just for a nanosecond. What's the stat I heard the other day, Sam? It was apparently every day people scroll TikTok the length of the Eiffel Tower. Right. So, you know, there's so much scrolling going on and, you know, attention is really, really hard to get when, you know, there's engaging video after engaging video. And people who are on TikTok who are smashing it on there, they're able to make those first 3 seconds really count. You know, they show you a funny image, a reaction. They've got words on the screen or they're wearing something or as 1-2 seconds of music hits in. That's just enough to make you stop for a second and go, yeah, I'll stay, right? And that's all you need to do is do that enough to then kind of get people into your funnel.
And you've got to think that, you know, smart marketing firms must be testing on TikTok, because TikTok will tell you what is and isn't viral much quicker, because the attribution of a view is so much better, because the video is full page and either people stay for it or they don't. Whereas on Twitter, there's like 4 or 5 posts on there. So you kind of get a heat map. On Facebook, there's a few different posts at once. So you've got to think, if you want to test ideas out, TikTok, and then take that content, put it elsewhere.
Well, I don't know. There's the algorithms work so differently for every platform, right? So I think you need to be on a platform long enough to get to know the people who are commenting and liking on your stuff, so that you can then...
Yeah, of course, because they expect different content.
Yeah, so that you can then honestly test with them. You know, like, I run a really small Facebook group for my membership. Like, there's less than 100 of us in there. But I know there's always going to be 10 people who are going to like and comment on stuff. So I've got a focus group of 10 people at all times that, you know, I can have stuff from. I think this podcast on YouTube in particular, right, you know, I think this is like the 20th, 21st episode or whatever, right? Is that we're at a point now where...
Is it?
I think so. That we roughly know what the average view time is, when the drop-off is, like, based on those episodes, and what the average kind of views are going to get. Like, we had one episode that went a bit spiky because we played on the Elon Musk kind of news at the time. But, like, mostly, like, there's a sort of relaxation now between us and the YouTube algorithm. And, you know, when we get to that point, then we can start going, okay, well, maybe we can change things because we know, like, people are going to watch it for this long or this long or this long or whatever. And on Twitter, you're going to, like, know if a particular tweet is going to get traction because it's got that kind of hookability, if you like. And you can keep putting those out, and then maybe every sort of one out of 10 tweets, like, try something different. But you have to go long enough to kind of see patterns in the engagement, in the reach, in the clicks, in the comments, etc. first, before you can kind of start making decisions, I think.
Not to go off on a tangent, because I want to nail why this is so important that we're talking about. But if we've recorded over 20 episodes, that puts us in the top 1% of all podcasts ever produced, because most people don't go past 20 episodes. Well, should we have a little party about that? Doesn't mean anyone's listening, though, hey?
Yeah, a party for two.
And our mums.
The guys from Views of My Own told me this. They put something really interesting out recently where they were like, if you have got past a certain amount of episodes, you're in the, like, that top percent. So yeah, we've done pretty well. But here, case in point, right? These episodes take an hour to film. They take Brian, goodness knows, 10 hours to edit. I don't know, a lot of time, right? They take Lydia up to an hour to load every week, and then optimizing YouTube. Then I do an hour of listening, research, titles, things like that, maybe 1 to 2 hours a week as well. So collect, and then you're doing your research as well. So collectively, you know, it's a kind of a team effort. There's quite a lot of hours going into this. And, you know, it could be this doesn't take off, right? Just doing what we're doing. But it could be that this takes off at episode 35, you know, or episode 72. And, you know, we have to make that decision as to whether we kind of continue on the same trajectory, or we make big alterations, or whether we just tweak ever so slightly here, there and everywhere, you know. And that's the beauty of doing content online, if you've got your data hat on, because you can either play it safe, and safe is good, at least you can get that consistency with knowing, okay, for every post I put out, like you said earlier, I'm going to get like this amount of cash back. Or you can gamble and have a little bit of fun with it here, there and everywhere.
Yeah, I mean, for me, this podcast is fun, like really enjoyable, and the research bit of it, really enjoy it. And it's useful for putting other content out there. But definitely, I think, and we've both had conversations with, you know, the people that are listening regularly, because we do have a regular group of listeners that tune into every single episode, send messages and say, oh yeah, I heard it, and give us some feedback. We, you know, that's very efficient. We're having this conversation with like 100 plus people every single week, and potentially in the future more that could go back and listen to this. The consistency, like you say, is a big part of what gets the growth. I mean, I'm seeing it on Twitter, like, and now I've got the consistency sort of dialed in, which is really hard. You've got to build a habit there. It's a lifestyle challenge, not a technical challenge. And I think it's the same with the podcast. Like, you've got to get over a level of discomfort with, well, this is just something I do. Like, getting up every morning, like, I need to put the bins out every day. I need to do the dishwasher every day. And, like,
it's why Facebook Lives really took off, I think, because the people who are really confident doing those could see that the more Facebook Lives they did, the more reach they got. And I think that's what led Helen Pritchard, again, to really taking off, because she was confident in doing a daily live. It was so habitual for her, and being able to talk about her life and everything and do it on a platform that might make other people feel uncomfortable as well, you know, that she kind of struck gold there eventually.
I want to dive into why this is important, because it was kind of funny, like, whilst I was doing my Twitter thing, Twitter's changed. In my experience, it's quite a constructive place now, whereas previously my experience of it was a bit negative and a bit trolly. It was full of people, you know, slagging people off.
Oh, there's still time for that.
There's still time for that. Well, I had a brilliant guy who from America, I think his profile was like, guns, military and football. If you don't bench 160, don't at me, or something like that. something inspiring. And, you know, I put a post out there. Just curious, you know, if you're not selling a digital product yet, why not? And his response was something like, you know, because people don't want virtual water from a virtual well, go get a real job. I was like, oh, I hope you're having a good day. But it did make me think, it's like, well, you know, I spent a long time in manufacturing, like knocking round bits of hard metal into square bits of hard metal and making something that was really valuable to people. And then went off and built some very expensive tech that nobody ended up wanting, you know, and spent a lot of my own cash. And the reason that this is so valuable is, you can, you know, for anyone that's listening going, ugh, more marketing, more social media, like, ugh, like the value in this is it kind of de-risks all the time and effort you can put into, let's call it, real things, like the business that exists. And if you are optimizing, after all, we are the chief optimization officers, if you're optimizing for life, lifestyle businesses, which, you know, Vicki and I are quite open, that's our, the thing that's important to us at the moment. There's a threshold there. You want a product that's £200 to £500 average transaction value so that you can deal with refunds and whatever else. And you need to get that footfall from the street, you need to get the digital version of that. And this is the efficient path to doing that. You need to go validate the idea, and then you can scale it digitally. And it's just, it allows you to do these things. You can schedule content out. You can spend a day, like we said, creating content, whether it's a podcast, whether it's a blog post, whether it's, you know, long form stuff, and then chop it up and schedule it for the week and schedule your interaction with people and have a link through to your thing that you're selling. And it can be a very efficient process. And that's really, I think, why this is interesting to me, and I think worth sharing.
Yeah, well, just to bookend this, right, I was talking about this morning, is content burnout still is real, right? And the getting on and the treadmill and having to think about new things to test and try and get in with people is hard work, especially, you know, if some platforms aren't your cup of tea. So if you're not a video person, but you need to reach your people on TikTok, good luck to you, you know. Or if you're very wordy, you're a wordy type person and, you know, you've been used to putting posts on Instagram and everything, and they've sort of taken that away from you and making you do video instead, you know, the same. But the use of AI in that content creation, I just can't recommend enough right now. And we spoke about it in last week's episode, which was, you know, is using AI cheating? No, it is not, friends. It is not cheating, right? I've been able to write 5 blog posts in the past week, get them up on my site. I'm aiming for 500 this year. You know, I need to answer all questions that people have about Facebook ads. I'm using ChatGPT to help me. How long would it normally take me to write 3 blog posts? 3 days, right? Facts, 3 days, right? And instead, I've been able to get all of my titles from an SEO tool, take those titles, give them to ChatGPT and say, can you write me some blog outlines? And then ask it to write the details of each of those sections of the blog outline as well. Game changer, game changer, you know. And that, you know, I'm not saying that that's going to fix everything, but if you're putting off creating YouTube videos because, you know, you don't know how to create a YouTube video that people would like, go and ask ChatGPT to write a YouTube video script for you. You know, if you're trying to think of a hook to talk about on your next video and you're stuck, you've got writer's block, go and ask ChatGPT, or go and ask your 100 people in your group and ask them what they would like to see as well.
Absolutely.
Yeah, like the content burnout thing is real, but there's tools definitely on their way to kind of help with that. And make sure it's really good quality as well, because we don't want ChatGPT just outputting hundreds of thousands, millions of really bad blog posts for the next 10 years. That would be a disaster, right?
I think you've got to look at it as if you're talking with a business savvy friend, like, you know, you and I bounce ideas around, we both have our groups that we go to with to chat about this stuff, and it's that catalyst of ideas, it's that refinement of thoughts, that's what it's there for, and it helps. So once you've like zoomed in on an idea, once you've asked your 100 people, once you've, you know, seen some data that says yes, you should go pursue this, you should pursue that with the best tools at your disposal. When you decide you want to go on holiday across the world, you don't set off walking. You know, you take the plane because it's more efficient, it's quicker. And no one says, oh, you didn't earn this holiday by you just want to get to the destination in the most efficient way possible.
Yeah, you say that, but I drove to Mongolia once upon a time. So we didn't fly, we drove.
Did you do the Mongol rally?
Yeah, I'll talk about it in another episode if you want, but yeah, we drove to Mongolia.
We should definitely do an episode on real life stuff that's cool that you should do more of. Yeah, that'd be cool. In summary, you can run a business in 4 hours a week, but the important thing is you want to build it first. So you want to use this 7-hour startup, you know, process that we kind of outlined. You want to define the product, come up with a hypothesis. If I sell this product to these people, then they'll buy it. go test that experiment and then validate by asking them to purchase or to give you more information. Like, and you can do that. It's as simple as a Facebook post, a tweet, a blog in the right place, in the right place. So very important. If you've got a hypothesis, you've got to say for a person, and always be thinking, you know, well, what kind of person? If they're remote worker, okay, what type of remote worker? They're an engineer. What type of engineer? They're a software engineer. They're a hardware engineer. They're an engineer and they make dishwashers. Like, always be thinking, what kind? And test that. Go test it. But it doesn't need to be a multi-million pound campaign. You don't need to go get a logo. You don't even need a business name. Like, just go ask people. And it's real fundamental market research. That's the place to start. And I guess we keep coming back to this. With a startup, if you're trying to optimize for lifestyle and everything else, get the idea right, and everything else is a lot easier, including the content. Like, it all stems from there. Like, these fundamental things, you got to get them right.
Definitely can't agree enough about validating any business idea on social. Just make sure you ask in the right place, and you might have to get out of your comfort zone going to the places on the internet that you're not used to going. And if that's the case, find a grown-up or someone who is more experienced with that community to help you, so that you don't make an ass of yourself in front of them, basically. And then once you are validated, keep going back to social again and again. Do what Elon is doing at the moment. That guy is no stranger to a poll on Twitter. Should I step down from Twitter or not? Yes, no. It's like the notes you used to pass at school. Are you my friend? Circle yes, no. Like, I was on a Zoom call last week, a really important one, and my daughter slid a thing in front of me and it said, can I play Roblox? Circle yes or no.
Oh, I like her style.
But that, you know, that is how we should be asking people stuff online, essentially. And once you've got over that validation idea, just don't hesitate from using social to test your ideas, you know, and then take the data that you get from those tests and feed them into crafting your message, crafting your product positioning, crafting the ideas for your content that you have as well. And then, you know, don't feel the pressure. I think final thing, I know I keep banging on about this, but don't feel the pressure to show up and create content 20 hours a day, every single day. Like, one amazing piece of content is better than, you know, that you split up into loads of bits, but one amazing bit of content is better than 20 pieces of content. We don't need more content out in the world, you know. We just want great ideas, things that make us think, things that make us stop and scroll. And it's an exciting game to play to figure that stuff out.
It is. Well, one final thing. If you are considering this type of thing is like going to be your career, really recommend joining some kind of community that's a bit of a safer space where you can test out these ideas a little bit in kind of a safer environment and get more in-depth feedback usually. Usually paid communities have better engagement, have better quality responses quite often. They're worth a look at, because then you can take what's working there and then go to social. If you want to slow the process down or just run out there and just say, hey, here's my thing, does anyone want it? That also works perfectly well. Yeah, go do it. Think of it as a test. Think it all of it as a test. None of it's like absolute. And the faster you can have a few failures, the faster you're going to get to the one that succeeds. Where can people find you, Vicky?
I'm on Twitter. I've decided to come back onto Twitter for a little bit and talk again. I choose my social platforms very carefully. I'm anti-LinkedIn at the moment. You won't find me talking on LinkedIn. But I'm back on Twitter chatting. So I'm Hey Vicky Jakes on Twitter.
Cool. You can find me at @Jax_Sam. That's JAXX_Sam, as you would expect, SAM on Twitter. Come and say hey. And if you've listened to this on Spotify or Audacity or wherever, we would be really grateful if you'd head over to YouTube, give it a like, give us a subscribe, and even if you're feeling super generous, cost you nothing, but it'll mean the world to us, give it a share with anyone else that you think might be interested. So share the YouTube video on your socials. In fact, you could even go test it for us and let us know what people think. Say, hey, does anyone want to optimize their business? Listen to this podcast. Till next week.
See you later.
Laters.